สวัสดีค่ะดิฉันสิริพรปันสวัสดิ์ค่ะ
ครับสวัสดีครับผมสุภกรสิทธิชัยครับ
ค่ะสำหรับหัวข้อของการเสวนาในช่วงบ่ายนะคะของงานประชุมวิชาการประจำปีสวทช.ครั้งที่13ในวันนี้นะคะต้องขอกราบขอบพระคุณท่านผู้บริหารระดับสูงนะคะจากหน่วยงานส่วนราชการค่ะทั้งในระดับจังหวัดนะคะซึ่งในวันนี้ทราบว่ามีท่านผู้ว่าราชการจังหวัดและท่านรองผู้ว่าราชการจังหวัดนะคะรวมทั้งท่านผู้บริหารและผู้แทนจากหน่วยงานภาคเอกชนนะคะและผู้มีเกียรติทุกท่านค่ะที่ได้ให้ความสนใจในเรื่องราวของเมืองอัจฉริยะหรือ Smart City นะคะซึ่งต้องเรียกได้ว่าเป็นประเด็นที่กำลังได้รับความสนใจทั้งในประเทศและต่างประเทศค่ะที่มีการนำเทคโนโลยีต่างๆนะคะเข้ามาบูรณาการเพื่อที่จะพัฒนาเมืองให้เป็นเมืองอัจฉริยะไม่ว่าจะเป็นเทคโนโลยีเซ็นเซอร์นะคะเทคโนโลยีทางด้านการประมวลผลภาพหรือจะเป็น Internet of Things ค่ะเพื่อนำมาปรับใช้นะคะพัฒนาเป็นบริการเป็นการดูแลด้านความปลอดภัยนะคะหรือว่าการอำนวยความสะดวกให้ประชาชนให้เมืองนั้นน่าอยู่มากยิ่งขึ้นค่ะและในวันนี้ค่ะเราจะได้มานำเสนอนะคะถึงความร่วมมือค่ะระหว่างภาครัฐและภาคเอกชนค่ะในรูปแบบที่เรียกว่า Public Private Partnership นะคะรวมทั้งแหล่งงบประมาณแล้วก็รูปแบบของการดำเนินธุรกิจที่เหมาะสมในการขับเคลื่อนให้เป็น Smart City โดยในการเสวนาวันนี้นะคะเราจะแบ่งออกเป็น3ช่วงที่สำคัญด้วยกันนะคะช่วงแรกค่ะวันนี้เรามีวิทยากรจากต่างประเทศซึ่งจะมาแลกเปลี่ยนประสบการณ์นะคะแล้วก็รูปแบบการดำเนินงานเมืองอัจฉริยะนะคะ2ท่านด้วยกันค่ะหลังจากนั้นเราจะพักเบรกกันสักครู่หนึ่งนะคะและเราจะกลับมาเข้าสู่เซสชั่นของการเสวนาค่ะเรามาดูการพัฒนาเมืองอัจฉริยะในรูปแบบบ้านเราแบบไทยๆว่าจะเป็นอย่างไรนะคะและช่วงท้ายสำหรับท่านที่สนใจค่ะมีข้อเสนอโครงการเกี่ยวกับการพัฒนาเมืองอัจฉริยะเราจะได้มาร่วมกันรับทราบแหล่งเงินทุนที่จะสนับสนุนการดำเนินงานค่ะ
Okay, good afternoon, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome you all to Thailand Science Park, especially the NASDA Annual Conference 2017. Today, the session is on public-private partnership, and we have distinguished speakers to share their experience on this topic. And I would like to introduce you to the two speakers today. The first one is Mr. Stephen McKay, director and founder of Creator Tech Australia. And second one is Mr. Yong Wee Tan, director of regional headquarters Crimson Logic from Singapore. Well, the two speakers will share their experience in the public-private partnership implementation. And hopefully, so far, you know, in Thailand, we have only discussed what technologies are available to solve problems, but we have never really tried to see how we manage those technologies with the cities for sustainable development. So I would like to welcome Mr. Stephen McKay for the first speaker, and please welcome Mr. Stephen McKay.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Sawadikap, Tampu Mikiet. Kortod, Kortod, put time I die, so I have to continue in English. And I'm also going through these slides quite quickly because time is limited. If I'm going too quick, just raise your hand and I'll go slower. If I'm going too slow, tough, I guess. So what I want to get through is a few examples here of Australian smart cities, where I come from. Three cities that have embarked on a journey, and it is a journey, nobody's ended it yet, to smart citydom. And then look at four companies that have grown up or are growing up in Australia with, we believe, thought-leading, innovative solutions and technology for enabling smart cities. very quickly look at the Australian Smart City and Communities Association, and what we are finding increasingly important in all aspects, including the funding and financing aspects, are what standards for the networking and what standards for the smart city build are emerging, which ones are going to last and which ones aren't going to. So, and there'll be a little bit of time for if anyone has any questions, I'd be delighted to take them. We're in the right place because Asia is really taking a large share of that. China is taking a disproportionately large share, not surprisingly, of the global facility services revenue, which is a fancy name for everything that's going on in smart cities. So the three emerging smart city projects in Thailand, six already established, it says 36 there, but I think that's optimistic, but 300 certainly underway in Thailand, many, many in Australia, of which I'll talk to you about three of them. This is one, Adelaide. There is currently a network of sensors being put in, both underground, as you'll see, and above ground, through Adelaide, which is in South Australia, to support the pilot smart city projects. And it's important to mention that it is a pilot. In Australia, the same as everywhere in the world, we're on the first, or in our case, probably the second step of a very, very long and interesting journey. And the priorities in Adelaide are managing energy consumption and reducing carbon emissions. As we go through the three different examples, you'll see, and this I think is important to the three projects in Thailand, you'll see that each city has its own different priorities, and that again influences what technology they're going to use, and that influences what funding or financing models would be suitable for them. They've already started saving an annualized $800,000, which if my sums are right is about 20 million baht per year. Take my glasses off to see this. Yeah, 20 million baht per year in what they've already done in lighting, which is nothing terribly fancy, a little bit of smart addition to their lighting, but changing for LEDs like many councils around the world have done. They do have a target to be the world's first carbon neutral city, which is a very, very ambitious target. And the rest of Australia is, and maybe the rest of the world, is interested to see their progress in that direction. Next one is Ipswich. You probably haven't heard of it. It's inland, if any of you know Brisbane. It's inland about 35 kilometres from Brisbane. And they've already been awarded three times one of the world's most intelligent communities awards. And in fact, one time in 2015, one of the top seven in the world for the work that they've done. This is underpinning their ambitions. So basically, their constituencies are twofold. They're trying to attract incoming business. They used to be a mining town living off coal mining. The last coal mine closed 9 years ago. And they're looking to attract new business and also visitors to Ipswich. And they're also got an ambition to improve their livability. Now, that's a whole complex subject, livability, which have different contenders for what are the metrics. But they're fully engaged in that. Their vision statement, which they spent a lot of money in working out and underpinning how we're actually going to achieve this, so it's not just blah, blah, is that Ipswich will be Australia's most livable and prosperous smart city. Now, prosperity is easy to measure, so the councillors who have come up with that vision have really put themselves up for on the hook for being measured up against that. Livability is a tougher one. And I have to thank at this point NEC Australia, parent company is a Japanese company, but NEC has been very, very helpful in giving me lots and lots of information that I'd be happy to share, but that I've distilled into three slides for that. Newcastle, we know about extremely well because it's my company, Creator Tech, that's helping them with their initiative. And they've fixed a definite date, 2030, 2030, that's 13 years' time, to be a smart, livable, and sustainable city. Three underpinnings of that: the connectedness, the environment, a green, healthy access to parks, but with sensing control to improve security and actually improve the environment in those parks and green spaces and sports areas, and the public spaces as an adjunct of that. The drivers of revitalization, they're old commercial buildings, they're restoring and in some cases completely renewing, and attracting businesses. Newcastle is about 100 kilometers north of Sydney, so in a sense they're competing with Sydney for companies, mid-sized companies, to put their headquarters, and certainly their regional headquarters, into Newcastle. The visitor economy, both overseas visitors and visitors within Australia. I visit Newcastle. They've got big sand dunes just outside Newcastle, which I enjoy doing four-wheel driving on. It's a good place for kids to visit, which it didn't used to be. Again, Ipswich being inland of Newcastle was very much a coal town, and then cultural and nighttime activities, which supplement the inbound tourism. They've got two overlapping areas. The one on the, let me see, on your left, covers most of the city. They're deciding which networks. We've now made a recommendation that they go with three different networks in that area. And the one on the right is a digital precinct based around the university there, the University of Newcastle, which will have very, very, very high-speed connectivity and cutting-edge technology in cooperation with and sometimes emanating out of the university. So we're very proud to be assisting them in them. In all those three cities that I've rushed through, the issues are complex. If you look at the funding and the financing, you start, who's going to pay? Well, a good model is user pays. Who are the users? Who are the beneficiaries? Is it the citizens? You know, bearing in mind that Ipswich wants to attract a lot of visitors, then some of the beneficiaries will not be the citizens who live there. Is it industry? And again, they're trying to attract inbound industry, so that should be a beneficiary, and that can have its offspin to the city in terms of tax benefits. And all of that impacts both on the funding and finance models, but also on the type of technology. All these issues are interrelated. Now I'm just going to take a quick look at four Australian companies. We've found that as the smart cities movement has moved forward in Australia, it's interestingly spawned off a whole bunch of initiatives, both from large companies, I haven't brought any examples of those today, implementing technology, usually other people's technology, but also of small companies. And while preparing for this seminar today, I've met 18 different small companies around Australia who were keen to share their information with me and through me with you. This company is called Smart Parking. It's based out of Melbourne. Oops, wrong one. Thank you. Thanks very much. My mistake. Can we get back to full screen? So they're based out of Melbourne, Smart Parking. I'll go quickly through what Smart Parking does, but of interest is they have projects not only in Australia, they've got a project in the city of Canberra, which is our capital city, but they've also got a project in Westminster in London. So for a small Australian company to achieve that is something that we're quite proud of. Thank you. Let's try again. This is their system. They put, it starts with putting under the ground sensors. Now that to a network person like myself immediately introduces problems. If you're communicating underground, you can only use different frequencies, different spectrum to if it's overground. The idea is, and I've seen this work in practice, you're driving along to a busy place to go shopping or ginkau, and you think, I don't want to spend all of my time parking. Actually, I had this experience right here last night. The nearby place to eat was full of students' cars, and we couldn't park. On the smart parking system, you see on your smartphone, or in future cars, built into your dashboard, here are three parking spaces, either on the road or in a multi-story. You are 5 minutes away. Would you like to reserve one? Oh, yes, please. Ping. Other cars are blocked from moving in there. You move into the parking space. It automatically, kind of like an Uber taxi or a Grab cab, I think you have more here in Thailand, automatically will deduct the payment, so you don't need to mess around with coins and credit cards for the amount of time you're parked there. And your experience as a citizen trying to park is much easier, much less painful. The interesting thing for the city council, is in Australia, and I think it's probably true in Thailand, most of the street parking spaces are owned or franchised by the council. So if you're optimizing the parking in those spaces, you're immediately optimizing your revenue as a council. So unlike a few smart city projects or applications, I call them, this one is almost immediately revenue earning for the council. Business overview, I think I've talked about that. I haven't mentioned that apart from England, UK, which I did mention, they have installations in, I don't want to press any of these buttons in case the same thing happens, but installations in New Zealand, in Singapore, Malaysia. Those are trials in Singapore and Malaysia, but they're going ahead. In the United Arab Emirates and in South Africa. The next one is a company that some people here that I've talked to have heard of. If you're interested in connected vehicles and autonomous vehicles, the self-driving car, you may have heard of Coda Wireless. They're about a 10, 12-year-old company based out of Adelaide, South Australia, and they are the leader, here we are, in V2X. V2X means vehicle to everything, so a number of examples are vehicle to infrastructure, which is what I'm going to talk about, vehicle to vehicle, which is used as an early anti-collision mechanism, and vehicle to grid, and there are three more. So it's an Australian-based vehicle to anything company. It dominates the vehicle to anything connected space. And it's now offering smart city infrastructures, which is the only bit I'm going to talk about. Yes, they're involved with Tesla. Yes, they're involved with the Chinese manufacturers of electronic vehicles. But I'm just going to talk about their smart city applications. So in the European Union, in Europe, the EU, they have four different projects. In the EU, up in that map, which isn't very clear, there's a freeway which runs through Austria down at the bottom, right up through Germany, up into the Netherlands, where I'll be going in 2 weeks' time. And they are involved in that, as I'll talk about next. There's a thing called Scoop, don't ask me what it stands for, which is a similar thing across France. there we are, the other map there. And there's yet another one called Nordic Way, which covers the Scandinavian countries. CODA involved in all of them. So they're the sole radio supplier on the German trial. It's a SIM trial, where essentially a SIM trial is inserted in a car. They've got a contract for 1,200 vehicles in the French project, and so forth. You can read the rest. But again, quite impressive for a small company. They've got a project in the city that I live in, the wonderful city of Sydney, and welcome you all to visit Sydney. It's a wonderful place, where trucks, as it were, will talk to traffic lights. And there's, I think, 100 intersections throughout Sydney where there's a sensor put on the traffic light, there's a sensor in the truck. This is a large vehicle which takes a long time to stop, as you know, a long time to start. And if it is taking a long time to start, it's backing up all the traffic behind it, slowing down the grid, the traffic grid. The sensor in the traffic lights essentially says that there's a truck approaching, leave the green light on for 10 seconds longer. And already in early trials, they've proved that improves the total traffic throughput, not just the trucks, in Sydney. I'm rushing on. The next one is called Solar Bins Australia. People who've heard of smart cities have usually heard of smart garbage. Solar Bins is, thank you, the Australian leader in that field. And this is their vision. Our vision is a world without waste. And the mission is to deliver the world without waste by overlaying technology into one of the most manually intensive industries, which is waste management. And here's how they do it. So it's founded very recently, just 6 years ago. Completely Australian company. It has its own patents. And those are their four brands. And just to summarize, if the waste management people who run the trucks and collect the garbage knew that this bin is only half full, no need to collect that, no need to go down this street, that soy, this one needs collecting, it really simplifies and makes more efficient waste collection. Second of all, if the bins were secure enough that rubbish stayed in them, didn't spill over, you reduce wastes, you also reduce pests. And essentially that's what they're offering a solution for. It's called Big Belly. Contains the waste much more efficiently than traditional waste collection things. And because it's smart, because it's wired up with all of these sensors that are communicating with the garbage trucks and the management headquarters, the collection of garbage is much, much more efficient than it used to be. The last one I think I talk about is, so in smart cities we've talked about visitors, we've talked about the council, we've talked about citizens. So some citizens are flourishing and working their way up. Some are approaching the twilight of their life, and they're older people, they're more vulnerable. Very important for a smart city to also take care of the more vulnerable people. And this company, ArcSense, is doing that in smart cities. So there are two versions, if you like, of aged care. One is keep them in their home as long as possible, and the other is make the nursing place, the aged care facility, a more efficient and more ever more pleasant place to be in. Both of them have their arguments. I'm not going to take sides on that. But whichever it is, by inserting sensors either in the home, these are very low cost sensors. And inserting, again, a low cost network in the home, you can detect, without people being 24/7 present, if there has been a slippage, if there has been a call, if an emergency service needs to attend. At the moment, this is being trialed with wearables. But the thing about a lot of old people, not just old people, is they don't like to wear something new. I actually don't, you know, so this is enough for me. And so if you're not wearing it, you can't press the alarm and get the emergency care there. This operates without wearables. It's actually installed within the home. Just for anyone who's slightly technical, a schematic of how it works. The sensors, which I mentioned, collects the data. There is an analytics applied to that data right through a nursing home or a series of nursing homes or a series of homes where the people are living. Results in incident detection. It results in changes to the way the individual is cared for, and it results in improved care. And three or four slides, so that's the end of the Australian Smart Cities. I would love to talk to you about 20, 30 more Australian companies, but that's enough for now. This is an association that my company is a member of as well, called the Australian Smart Communities Association. It's creating a network of smart communities throughout Australia and also with overseas participation, as you'll see in a minute. And its members represent one in every three Australians. So there are enough councils, as well as private companies like my companies, signed up that it represents 30%, one in three of all Australians. Its activities, including policy and advocating to the government, you know, we think you should pay attention to this area, we think you should support that area. It has six national seminars per year and an annual conference. And last year, I participated in a conference that we had inviting a Dutch contingent. I've said before, we regard the Dutch and Amsterdam as very advanced in their smart city thinking. They came over with their queen, the Queen of the Netherlands, large contingent, a medium-sized contingent, to visit us, advise us, learn from us. And we made huge progress by exchanging ideas, exchanging technologies. I'm actually, I might have mentioned, on my way to Holland in a few weeks' time, after Songkran. And this is its membership structure. It's a bit of an eye chart, but I kept it in because over on the right it says the way that, if anyone's interested, international organizations get involved through the international partnership work stream. And these are some of the things that the members are doing. Or I think all of these companies, all except one that I talked about, they're all members of this. So you'll see the smart parking, the smart waste, but there are many others. Because my colleague here from Singapore is going to cover this in great depth, I'm just touching on these finance and funding options in two slides, which model to use. The current Australian government, with a bit of input actually from us, is really keen on a funding mechanism called value capture. When you look into value capture, it's a pretty wide mechanism. It can still cover a lot of options. What is undoubtedly true, and we find on every project that we do, is you cannot divorce the funding or finance mechanism from the type of infrastructure being built. You can't divorce the type of infrastructure from the policies of that council or that local government. And you cannot divorce the policies from their vision. So I talked about three Australian cities, and each one of them had a slightly different vision. One more in carbon reduction, one more in renewal of their business. And those affect the technologies they're putting in, the applications they're putting in, and very much affect the financing model. So just as an example, if your type of infrastructure is smart traffic lights and road signage, and your objective is to increase your transport efficiency, then a relevant finance model, and it's been used very successfully for a long time in Singapore, I actually lived there when it was first put in, was one of the first city in the world, I believe, to put in CBD charging. So that's relevant to that. It's not relevant to, other... Here are some other financing options. transit-oriented developments used in Hong Kong and used in a couple of cities in Canada. So if an MRT is being built in Hong Kong, they know it's going to increase the value of the housing and the buildings and the shops nearby. And the development of the station is partly subsidized through taxes on adjacent properties, rates. Congestion charges, again, for things that are optimizing your transport efficiency are relevant. Wouldn't be relevant to things that are optimizing your aged care. This is one that kind of summarizes it, is that, again, if you don't... What is the future of smart cities? Which technologies which are being developed for smart cities now, and I'll talk about them in a minute, are going to carry on and flourish, and which ones are going to die? And until you take that into consideration, we in Australia and everyone in the world are taking a big risk that no matter how smart we are about funding and financing them, it's going to be wasted money if it goes into something which really doesn't survive. Now, I've been told to keep this at a friendly level, technologically, so I'll try to do that. Basically, there are about half a dozen different networks which are being developed for smart cities. They all need to be able to do two things. Number one, be able to send very, very small packets of information, very, very small signals, unlike the telephone network, which the more voice we use, the more data we use, the more video we use, has to have large wideband traffic. So in smart cities, it's called narrowband, or it's called IoT narrowband. You're just talking about sensors sending a tiny little packet of information, sometimes twice a day. So that's the first thing. It has to be able to deal with low cost, low amounts of traffic. And the second thing is it has to be cheap. Cheap, cheap, cheap. If you're going to put 10 sensors in this building, in a year's time it'll be 100 sensors. If each sensor is going to cost you, let's say, 2 baht per month, suddenly that becomes 200 baht per month and multiplies throughout the city. So it needs to start off cheap and get cheaper. This is very, very, very important. These are the names of some of the contenders. Wi-Fi exists mostly. We're advising Newcastle. Newcastle has Wi-Fi everywhere. It's free because it's already been installed. So we've said, please continue using Wi-Fi. LoRa is a big contender. One of the advantages of LoRa is it's a do-it-yourself technology. You don't have to go to a telco. Sigfox is a telco. It comes out of France. Its company in Australia is called Thinxtra, and they're developing a very low-cost network. They've developed it throughout Australia and New Zealand. They're starting on Hong Kong. I'm not sure if they're coming to Thailand, but that's definitely a contender. So the essential thing when you're looking at networks, when you're looking at sensors, and has implications for funding, is not to get locked in. You don't want to get locked into one vendor in case either that vendor puts prices up too much, you don't want to pay that price, or the vendor goes out of business. You do not want to get locked into one vendor. And if it's a small vendor, they may be very cheap, they're very, very competitive, they may be very good to deal with. But small companies, again, you stand a risk of them going out of business. So the big question comes, what is the standard? Is there a standard? I can buy it from you today and put it in, and if you're out of business or you're too expensive, I can buy the same thing from him and put it in. And nobody yet knows what the standards will be. This is our job to figure out what is emerging, and this is what we advise cities on. There's a lot of contenders. Here we go. British Standards Institute, ISO, the International Standards Organization that's dominated telco standards to an extent. There's a very interesting one that I'm going to have discussions with in London called HyperCat, which is designed just for smart cities. I don't know if they'll be it, but they're a contender. So what is the candidate for the Smart City Standard? I'm not here to give answers, but I am here to say it's an essential question. Just talk very quickly about my company, our capabilities, understanding the need for a digital smart city platform, critical infrastructure management. So once you have more than one project, maybe you have a smart bins project and then you put in a smart lighting project, then suddenly you have a bunch of projects that need central management. So that's one of our capabilities. And these are some of our clients. I should put City of Newcastle on there, but there's some well-known names. You'll recognize the name IBM. Oh, City of Newcastle is on there, good. You'll recognize Siemens. And so just to summarize, I think I'm just about within time, on what I've been trying to say for the last few minutes, is smart cities need strong and clear leadership. The leader, the mayor of Ipswich, Paul Pazzali, very strong, clear man. He also has a background in IT, which helps. It's not essential, but it helps. But he also gets 80% of the vote because he's made sure that everyone in Ipswich understands what he's trying to do, and 80% of them agree with it. 20% don't, I guess. The issues are complex. You cannot say the issues are all solved when you get the right policies. You cannot say the issues are solved when you get the right money. It helps, but... and the issues are also interrelated. And really the decisions on what network or what networks a city uses and what standards are adopted are critical. I think that's the last slide, so Kap Kun Kap. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, please let me know. Mike?
Thank you very much, Mr. Steve McKay. And next speaker who will share about experience and showcase about smart city. May I invite Director Regional Headquarter Crimson Logic from Singapore. Please welcome Mr. Yong Wee Tan.
Good afternoon. My name is Wee Tan. Thank you very much for your time this afternoon. And before I start, I'd like to thank Dr. Pascon for inviting us to speak at this event today, and also to Phoenix ICT for doing the introduction. Yeah. Thanks, Steve, for that presentation on smart cities and some of the examples and all that. What I'd like to do for my presentation is to focus a little bit more on private, a public-private partnership, PPP. Right. So if you look at the session today, I'll really be focusing on this. Today, can we get the next page? So in terms of the outline, very simple about us. I'll go into some topics about PPP. It can get quite boring, PPP. Yeah. So please try to stay awake. I know it's after lunch. Yeah, and then I'll share a few case studies. So about us very quickly, Crimson Logic, some of you already know us. We are a Singapore IT company. If you look at our shareholders here, these are predominantly government agencies, except for Singtel, which is a public company. We have about 850 employees around the world across 14 offices. And we've done projects really across 30 over countries, and in terms of number of projects, more than 50. We specialize in e-government systems. That's how we started life for the Singapore government. Some of the projects that we have in America, including Canada and the Panama, and then we have 14 offices. Then in Middle East Africa, all the way from UAE, Oman to Madagascar, Mauritius, Madagascar, not the cartoon, huh? This is a real project, huh? Right? Madagascar. And then over 30 countries. So I look after the business for this part, Southeast Asia and rest of the world. So we have customers in all these areas. Yeah? So very quick, just to give you a sense of what we have been doing. Now, in terms of the PPP project, we have about 28 years of experience already. We started life as a PPP company, really, to run the national single window for the Singapore government or Port of Singapore Authority long time ago. In this time, 1989, right? We did this project. And then since then, we have been going on to run more projects. So that was our first PPP in 1989. And the most recent one was 2016, last year, where we did this for the Rwanda government. It's an e-government portal to provide government to citizen, government to business, government to government interaction for e-services on a PPP model. So later on, I will share more details of how we did that project. Yeah? So why PPP? In short, PPP is really a collaborative model between the government and the private sector to provide services to your citizens or to your businesses, to your stakeholders. Very simple. It is a financing model. It's a financing option, right? If you look at it, there are examples of PPP that we have done that is based on a DBO, which is Design, Build, Operate. So we actually help design the system with the government. We build, we operate for a number of years until the government says, okay, enough, okay, then give us back the system, a DBO system. Or we can have a model where it's a DBFO, where we actually put money into the system, into the project. We finance. And at this point, I think if you look at Crimson Logic, we are probably one of the few technology vendors that actually dips into our pocket and actually finance the project. And because partly because that's how we were born 28 years ago. So very familiar with that. Why PPP? If you look at governments today, what is the core business of government? Anyone? To build computer systems? Not really. A government's job is not to build computer systems. A government's job is to set policies, guidelines, regulations, govern. That is what a government is, whether it's a city government or a national government. So technology, systems, you should give it to the people who can do it, right? And try to transfer the risk of systems to the vendors, right? If you look at technology today, the obsolescence, it comes very fast. Every 2 years, every 3 years, something changes. As a government, you do not have enough bandwidth, do not have enough capacity to actually manage that, what we call technology obsolescence risk. So there are a lot of reasons why you should do that. Number one, lower capital upfront. So as a government, you have many priorities. You need to build a road. You need to put in a lot of the infrastructure like sensors and all that for your smart city. You don't have enough money. Why do you want to go and invest a lot more? So you invest less. So lower capital upfront. Secondly is, if you do that, you actually reduce your technology risk because you are passing the technology risk. Okay, get the vendor to buy. Yeah? You don't have to pay for it. Right? The third thing is, you actually promote greater sector benefits because you're triggering reforms in your public sector and in your private sector. And that's very critical for your city or your country to move. Last but not least, you improve service quality. If it's not improved, it is definitely faster, right? I speak about all this because I came from IDA, Infocom Development Authority of Singapore. So we are very familiar with this, right? In terms of PPP, how it helps to deliver all this benefit to the citizens. I only see two people sleeping, so it's still quite okay, huh? Everybody's still paying attention. Okay, very quickly, if you look at structure and consideration, one of the most common vehicle that we use or structure that we use for PPP is setting up a SPV with the stakeholders or special purpose vehicle. I think later on when we have the different cities to come and present, this is something that you're already very familiar with, right? But I think for the sake of the audience, if I can just share a little bit, right? An example of a PPP structure involving SPV. So here is your SPV right in the center, which is your project company. That is the one that is supposed to develop, operate, maintain the system, right? Then you have the government implementing agency, which provides a concession or PPP contract to the SPV. You have the stakeholders or the users here, right? Who may be other ministries or other agencies using the system, so there's revenue coming in. You have the citizens and the businesses, also revenue coming in. In return, you provide services, right? Very simple, vertical, right? Left and right, you have the EPC or the OEM contractor. In this case, maybe like a Crimson Logic. We provide the system, we build the system, we design with you. We operate and we manage. Then on the left here, you have the financing, right? So financing can come from equity providers, or it can even come from banks, right? One of the things about PPP is that you can use the SPV as a vehicle for co-investment, or what we use bankability. How bankable is your project, right? If you look at it, if you are able to increase this, then this becomes a lot more viable. And I think I'll be sharing some of these slides with the event. So if someone you're interested, please let me know. Scopes and responsibility, ease of administration as a government. So I'm speaking very much from a government perspective. As a government, what do you want to do? Do you want to deal with 15 technology suppliers or do you want to deal with one? Like building a house, you deal with one contractor, right? Chamai? Huh? You don't deal with the electrician, the plumber, everyone else. You deal with one guy, the prime contractor. So that's what PPP will allow you to do, right? So the roles between the government and the operator are quite distinct. Government sets the strategy, the priorities. It sets the user service outcome, user charge. For example, if you're providing something that is an essential service, as a government, you don't want, because a private company comes in, the price to go up too high, right? People will not like you, your citizens will not like you. So you work together with the operator to determine the system requirement, who will then undertake the system development, maintenance, and operation directly, or work with third parties to deliver the system to you, right? Then what is very interesting is if you have a PPP model, your contract as a government, you can specify that if you are the winner of this PPP contract, I want you to develop my local capability. Whether you're a French company, a Singapore company, or a Dutch company, I want you to make sure that my people learn. So when you exit after 5 years or 10 years, my people are already able to run. And that's very important. A lot of contracts forget that. Yeah? Very briefly on user charges and investment. Obviously, okay, if you look at the graph, very simple. It's a user charge. That means this is the charge you charge the citizen or the business and the investment. The more investment you have from the private sector, the higher the price. The more investment you have from the government, then the lower the price. So what do we do? Sometimes the government steps in and provides a subsidy. For example, to make passport. Maybe to make passport is... How much to make passport now? Anyone? 1,000 Thai baht, for example, 1,000 Thai baht. So let's say we make it electronic, make it very simple, deliver to your house. You don't have to go to the office. But now the charge is 2,000 Thai baht. But the government says, maybe it's too high for my citizen. Okay, I will subsidize 1,000. Right? But I provide better service to my citizen. Straight away, your ranking or your popularity as a government or as a service goes up. How do you determine the user charges? A few things, right? Here, for example, they may. So if it's a traditional government, this is a normal way, right? You want to impose charges so you can recover your cost of putting in the system. But in a PPP, right, you work with your PPP partner to actually draw out the investment over a longer period of time. So you don't have that pressure that today, if I invest in a $10 million e-passport system, 10 million, so I must try and recover the money in maybe 5 years. With a PPP, maybe you can tell the PPP partner to stretch it out and recover in 15 or 20 years. So then you have less pressure, right, in terms of your financing. This is quite boring because it's really, PPP is boring. Huh? It's really a lot of details here. Then the other thing is about ownership, very important. System ownership, IP ownership, data ownership, all these things are very important. What do you need to do? How do you need to consider them? Right? So there are standard guidelines that are here. I won't read through every single one of them, but essentially, you need to work with a PPP operator who knows how to navigate this with you. A lot of governments that we work with, they say, okay, I want to give you a very short time, right? Only 3 years, 5 years, right? But then the thing is, if you want to give a short time, the cost goes up. Because as an operator, I want to recover my money fast. Yeah, as a PPP operator. So the graph is very simple. The longer the concession period, the number of years, the lower the price. Very, very simple economics. Okay, when is a project ideal for PPP? These are some of the common things that we have found from our experience. Modest transaction fee, so there has to be a transaction fee. You cannot PPP something that has no transaction fee. Yeah, then your citizens or businesses will be very angry. I never pay, why now you make me pay? Right? My dear. So then the services are new. It helps, it's a new service. You can charge, right? And there's no reference pricing to that. And then successful PPP is when they work together, when the private sector and the government work together to continually invest to support long-term. When we say long-term, how long is long? We have run PPP for governments that starts from as short as 5 years to as long as 20 years. So it depends on the horizon and how committed your stakeholders are to run the project. Okay, so I've given you a short background on what PPP is. I hope that was useful. So now let me share with you some of the case studies or the customers that we've had before. Singapore, TradeNet, National Single Window. We first launched this in 1989, and it's okay, just to explain to very quickly to everyone, what is National Single Window? It basically links traders, haulers, shipping lines, freight forwarders, agents, stakeholders of a port that needs to do custom declarations. Yeah? Instead of going to individual ministries or agencies to, okay, I need to, for example, I'm importing meat from Brazil, I need to go to different agencies to get the permit. Instead of going like that manually, automatic. Same, I think in Thailand, you already have that for your Thai customs. So we did this on a PPP. It was a design, build, operate PPP. We were responsible, or rather we invested in the system development, the maintenance and operations, as well as marketing to all the different stakeholders to use the system and also user training. So to the point that we even provide a service if there is a trader who wants to import something but doesn't even have a computer, doesn't know a computer, we actually help the person go online to type things for them for a fee. So we collect money also. Yeah? So this is SingPass. In order to be a smart city or smart nation, we have to have an online ID. I think many of you are familiar with the Singapore SingPass. Essentially, it's an online ID that allows you to access whole of government e-services. So you don't have to remember different ID passwords. We did this, I think about 15 years ago. Design, build, operate. Same thing. We invested in development, maintenance, operation, as well as mass adoption. So we actually did roadshows to the ministries, to the agencies, to community centers, everywhere, to make people adopt the technology, explain to them. Yeah. And the fee is determined by the respective ministries agencies. So we get paid. SingPass is a common platform. So there is Ministry of Law, Ministry of Traffic, Ministry of Home Affairs. Every time I do a transaction, if the ministry charge a fee, I get a percentage of that fee as the PPP operator. This is something we did for UAE. It is an online services, e-services portal for the Ministry of Justice. So not purely, not every PPP is purely money-driven. In UAE's case, it was really to provide faster, easier service for the citizens for e-justice. Yeah? It's a big country, UAE, so for them to actually go anywhere, it's difficult. So this allows them the convenience. Right? So there's a social goal behind it also, social objective. This is our latest PPP, just to share with you, our latest PPP example. This is for Rwanda. Rwanda, you know gorilla in the mist? This is where you go see gorillas, right? Rwanda in Africa, right? We've developed this system. It was a design, build, finance, and operate PPP. It was awarded to the SPV. Remember the SPV picture I showed you? So it wasn't awarded direct to Crimson. It was awarded to an SPV where we have a equity stake inside. So it was awarded to the SPV. The SPV then developed the system, maintain, operate, market, and then do the user training. Right? So that's what we did here. Crimson, as part of the SPV, this was what we did, system development, maintenance operations, and we work with local ICT SMEs to build local capacity. So in 3 years' time, 5 years' time, there will be a lot of Rwandan people who will know how to operate the system. This was launched late last year, late 2015, and the whole of 2016. So to date, we have 44 online services. Things like permit, driving license, marriage, certificate. In Rwanda, you have to get a certificate of being single. You must prove you're single before you can marry someone else. Yeah? So maybe we need that for Thailand, huh? For some naughty people. So then you have, across we have 44 online services. The target is 250 online services. Yeah? So this is only the first year, and we're tracking really well. Today, we go across 8 ministries and agencies, all the way from Ministry of Immigration, Police, Ministry of Tourism. If you want to go to Rwanda now to see the gorilla in the mountain, you have to pay $700 US. Panga, very expensive. $700 US to see the gorilla. And you can apply for the permit here. Right? You apply for the permit here. Please apply for a permit here because Crimson Logic will get a percentage. Yeah? And this is all integrated with payment, electronic payment, Visa, MasterCard, and soon China Union Pay. That's it. Kokung Kap. Any questions? Yes, sir.
So I have questions. So when we do the PPP, it's like we stick with one vendor, with one platform, like you are provide for the Lavanda. So the question is, what if that we want, the new technology is coming and the government want to make a new service or new platform, but we log in with this, lock up with this platform. It's like the one that you mentioned. So the question is, how to make it more open?
The, That's a very good question, because in a PPP, you're locked in for a period of time, right? Maybe 10, 15 years.
Yeah, and one platform.
Chai. Or at least one partner. One partner. So to share a little bit more, this SPV here is majority owned by the Rwanda Ministry of Finance. We only have a small part. And our role is to make sure that the services get rolled out faster, quicker, easier. If the majority shareholder of this SPV wants to say, I want to move from technology A to technology B, because now it's my ICT dream, I want to go from here to here, right? The government has a full right to ask the SPV, in this case, the technology provider, to change. So there is not as much as a lockup as you would imagine there is. For us, we also want to make sure that the system continue to run. And if there's a better technology that is there, it will be in our interest to adopt the better technology, cheaper, like what Steve said, sensors got to proliferate and get cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. So if there's cheaper technology, it is in our interest to actually adopt and move.
มีท่านใดมีคำถามเพิ่มเติมไหมคะ
Questions? Thank you very much. ขอบคุณครับ
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Yong Wee Tan. And on behalf of National Science and Technology Development Agency, the organizer of NASDA Annual Conference, I would like to invite Mr. Stuart Reed, Australian Trade Commissioner on stage.To present a souvenir for our two speakers. Please welcome Mr. Stuart Reed. And thank you very much, Mr. Steve McKay from Creator Text Australia.And another speaker. Thank you very much, Mr. Yong Wee Tan, Senior Director, Regional Headquarters, Crimson Logic from Singapore. Thank you very much, Mr. Stuart Reed.ค่ะแล้วเดี๋ยวขออนุญาตพักเบรกนะคะสักครู่ค่ะเพื่อที่จะได้จัดเวทีนะคะเดี๋ยวช่วงที่2ค่ะเราจะเป็นการเสวนาเพื่อมาแลกเปลี่ยนนะคะถึงรูปแบบค่ะ PPP แบบไทยๆในบ้านเรานะคะว่ารูปแบบความร่วมมือจะเป็นอย่างไรค่ะด้านหน้าห้องประชุมนะคะมีขนมและเครื่องดื่มบริการทุกท่านนะคะแต่ว่าอยากให้กระชับเวลากันสักเล็กน้อยนะคะเพราะว่าวันนี้วันศุกร์แห่งชาตินะคะเรายังมีเรื่องราวอีกมากมายนะคะที่อยากจะมาร่วมแลกเปลี่ยนกับทุกท่านนะคะขออนุญาตให้ทุกท่านกลับมานะคะภายในเวลา15นาฬิกานะคะหรือว่า3โมงตรงนะคะจะได้เข้าสู่การสัมมนานะคะในช่วงต่อไปค่ะ